Dave Rempis and others here as part of the Elastics series. So I'm really thrilled to be here again, whatever it is, 21 years later. Since then I successfully raised a child and started a nonprofit in Santa Fe. She's an amazing 20-year-old who's living independently and very happily in Maine. And this music you're about to hear is a series of pieces I've written over the course of COVID. The quick story is that January, the first year of COVID, somebody said, hey, there's a residency in Death Valley. And I grew up in Southern California, I love the deserts. And I thought, a residency in Death Valley would be a perfect thing to do with January. The nonprofit that I helped to run is usually, it's a quiet time of the year. And so I thought, okay, I'll apply for this Death Valley residency and write music for a month in the deserts, and this could be great. My daughter's off to college, and so I can actually dig in and begin creating new works again. And as soon as I hit submit on the grant, I realized that it was for the January thereafter. I was like, oh gosh, but this January is perfect, so I sold my high-efficiency automobile and bought a low-efficiency 4Runner and went to the deserts. I built a camping setup where I could compose during the day and sleep outdoors at night and just see what happened. And so sure enough, a lot of music came, and it's been great. I write largely in the Sonora Desert, and increasingly I've been writing at the Barry Goldwater Missile Range in southwestern Arizona, right on the border. It's a place where they still bomb, but the parts they don't bomb are the Tenajas Altas, which is this range here, which is one of the greatest wildernesses remaining in the United States. Ironically, they're on a missile range. So tonight you'll be hearing music largely from that missile range. So we're going to get started here. Before we do, I just want to let you know who you will be on this adventure with. You'll be hearing Sam Scranton on the drums. And the very marvelous Rob Lundberg, who I've met in Santa Fe about 10 years ago, on the bass. Yeah. And then Jeff Kimmel on the clarinets. And so this is a piece called Copa Night. And I'll tell you a little bit about it later on. Thank you. difficult access, so I'd be totally alone. And my very first camp was totally perfect. It was granite. It was a very extremely beautifully remote place. This was in January of 2020, so it hadn't rained in the Sonora for 11 months. And I set up camp and immediately found myself super productive and writing all sorts of music. And after 4 days, I was in such a groove. I was thrilled. And so I was sitting there I just had my coffee and my breakfast, and I was sitting at my desk writing music, and I heard the sound of a honeybee. And that's an unusual thing to hear in this scorched desert. And, you know, single sound of a honeybee. And that was fine, cool, whatever. Delighted that there are critters. And I got back to work. About 4 minutes later, there was the sound of two honeybees. And it's that semitone of two wings beating, which creates a little anxiety. And I thought, uh-oh, this is a trend. And sure enough, about 5 minutes later, there were about 10 honeybees in camp. And and so it was me and the honeybees. And I was super productive. And they were buzzing around me constantly. And there was this constant sound of bees. And it was beautiful and dreadful. It lasted all day long. And that was my first camp there. As long as the sun was in camp, so were the honeybees. And for about 4 days, I handled it. And on the fourth day, I just couldn't do it anymore. And I packed up all of camp, and I put everything into the truck, and hiked out about a mile and a half from camp. And sure enough, they followed me and stuck with me. And I was, at this point, I had slowly taken camp apart, hoping that it would deter them. And I had actually put out a bowl of water about half a mile from camp, hoping that they would drink that water and leave me alone, but they would just make a beeline, as it were, between their hive and camp and wherever I was in the water. And so they just kind of did that pattern for the whole time I was there. And so on this fourth day, I set up underneath a big ocotillo tree, which was some of the spiky Sonoran things you saw earlier on. You'll see more ocotillos later on. I set up underneath an ocotillo tree, and I wrote this piece. It's called Ocotillo and Sunbeam. That's the ocotillo. Thank you. year of this trip. It was the first year I went to the Bulgaria Goldwater missile range. And after about 2 weeks in the desert, I took a break, visited my family in California. And then I left and went to actually where you saw, actually the Mojave Desert, which is where those burned. There's a part in the Mojave Desert which is absolutely beautiful, but there had been a huge fire set by a campfire, which burned about 10,000 acres of Joshua trees. And that's what that was that you saw. And it was so depressing. It was burned, and there was one campsite, and it was all covered in trash, and it was just super depressing. So I left it and started driving east looking for a place to camp. And my younger brother called me and said, hey, you might want to hang out for a little bit. Dad's in the hospital. He seems to have had a little heart attack. I think he's going to be okay. He said, you know, but why don't you just find some place to perch for a while and see how things go. And so I looked over, and there was this collection of rocks up off the highway, maybe about 10 miles. And I thought, okay, I'll find a dirt road and drive up towards that. So a preserve called the Copa Preserve in western Arizona. And as I was driving up this pretty crappy dirt road, there was an old guy walking in a cowboy hat in the middle of the desert, like no cars or anything, nobody else. And I rolled down the window and I said, hey, are you okay? Is everything okay? And he said, yeah. He said, I just like walking in the desert. And I said, listen, I'm looking for a good place to camp for a few days. He said, oh my God. He said, there's heaven on earth just about 4 miles ahead up against those rocks. And he said, if you go up there and go up over the ridge, you'll see that there's a really bad road, but you get to the top of that road and there's this plateau and it's the best camping ever. And so I thought, okay, I'll go there and camp and wait on news of my dad. And this was where I ended up, a totally beautiful place. And I was absolutely thrilled to be there. I'm actually telling the wrong story. But this is actually that place. It's Kofa, and so you'll hear music from this place here. But actually the story I wanted to tell you actually is a story about the next piece, which is called Complimentary Microwave. And that's from this year. My girlfriend is a British art director in the fashion industry, and she was working in London, and she said, hey, I'm going to be flying back, why don't we meet in Phoenix? Because she was going to fly back through Phoenix, and I was going to drive through Phoenix. So I picked her up at the airport, we got a hotel, and it had a complimentary microwave. And she's British, and so she asked for a cup of tea. And so I got a little cup, there was no teapot, but there was a microwave, and I put water in the microwave and turned it on. And the amazing thing was, the microwave made an absolutely stupendous A major chord first inversion. And so I sang this song with that microwave, recorded into my phone, and that's what we're gonna play for you. It's called Complimentary Microwave. And you'll also be seeing, I think, some critters. Thank you. tree, very spiky. It has no leaves. It's called Palo Verde because the whole tree, all the limbs are green, which is where it gets its photosynthesis. So this is called Verde.
Thank you.
4 days and writing an unbelievable amount of music. It was the weirdest thing ever. I was so afraid and yet super productive. And one night about 3 o'clock in the morning, I wrote this piece. It's called Queen Canyon Field of Stars.
Thank you.
also has these incredible granite pockets that hold water and therefore lots of animals. It's also the range that Trump blasted the wall through, and it cuts right through the white granite. It's incredible. It's like some bizarre 1970s piece of land art. It's very disturbing. And there it is. And it's completely, the hilarious and horrible thing about it is it's for show. I mean, you can walk right around it. It's in a very remote place. There's no way in the world, if you cross the border there, you have 70 miles of desert and a missile range. It would be a very bad place to cross the border. And so there's no footprints, there's no helicopters, there's no cameras, nothing. But it's blasted through the granites. And also north of this refuge is Yuma, Arizona. And so I would go and I would get provisions every couple weeks up in Yuma, Arizona. And so you'll see some of this next series of videos. You'll see elements of Yuma and other things, our surrounding infrastructure. So this is a piece called Windy Josh. It's about my friend Josh Smith, who's from Cleveland, Ohio, great tenor saxophone player, now living in New Orleans. And we're gonna play it as our final piece. So thank you so much for being here. Again, you will be hearing the performance mind destroys any capability of remembering my own name, let alone others. This is Sam Scranton, here on the drums. Rob Lundberg on the bass. Jeff Kimmel on the clarinets. And Chris Jonas, thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you.